Greetings, Earth enthusiasts. If you ever wondered about the incredible perspectives our planet has to offer from high above here in the right place, I am Dr. Clive Coetzee, and I'm thrilled to be your guide on this captivating journey into the world of remote sensing. Welcome. And please remember to like, subscribe to, and share this video. Thank you.
A natural progression from conducting spatial autocorrelation or spatial correlation is spatial regression. In the previous video tutorial, this 132, we spent quite a bit of time on calculating the Moran I statistic, which is a measure of spatial autocorrelation or spatial correlation. And we went through all the functionalities of that with options within GeoDA. So for this particular video tutorial, we're going to turn our attention to spatial regression within GeoDA. Now, I don't necessarily use this in GeoDA too much. I prefer to do spatial regression within RStudio simply because the options are much greater than in GeoDA. In GeoDA, you only have two spatial regression models, lag, spatial lag, and spatial error. That's the only two. In RStudio, I think there's about 8 or 9 of them. I can't remember. So I prefer to use it. But within RStudio, I use the spatial weight matrices that we generated in GeoDA. Anyway, nonetheless, for illustrative purposes, let's go for it. So we're going to click on regression. We're going to open regression. And first thing that we're going to have to do is to present our equation. Okay, our regression equation. And that's the one that that we used in same one that we used in RStudio. So it's our ndvi, which is a function of elevation, of range. So to add this, you just double click, or you can highlight it and just use these buttons. And to delete them, you can just go the other way around. So either way, that's what you can do. So there's our standard regression. So I'm not going to include a weights matrix at this stage. We're just going to run it as if it's a normal time series model. Space doesn't matter. We don't bring in space at all. So let's run it. And it gives you a little window. We can expand on this window. And there's all the information. And let's just make it a little smaller. Yep. So that's our model. And that's our output. I can't remember the exact detail of the model output in RStudio, but vaguely, can vaguely remember R adjusted R square about 4 thereabout, and I think these coefficients are the same, and it shows you that all these coefficients are statistically significant. So first impressions is that the model seems fine. However, if we go to the diagnostics, which is these ones here, first diagnostics is for normality within the error term, and with this low probability, we reject the null hypothesis, which is that the errors are indeed normally distributed, and we accept the alternative, which means that here the errors are not normally distributed, and that could be because of this low R square. There's a whole lot of things that we are missing in our equation, so there's some important variables that we're missing. And that should or could sort out this non-normality of the errors. So that's a first problem. So these coefficients may be biased. They may not be, might be spurious. So just be wary of it. And then to further illustrate this, we also look at the test for heteroscedasticity. And what's alternative is homoscedasticity. So the null hypothesis is that it's homoscedastic. The alternative is that it's heteroscedastic. Given the probabilities, we reject the null hypothesis of homoscedasticity and we accept the alternative of heteroscedasticity. Again, it suggests that there's something wrong with this model. There's something missing. And again, that comes back to our low adjusted R square. So something here. We're missing an important variable in our model. Could that be space? Who knows? We're going to test that now. Or is it another variable? It could be, for example, wind. I don't know. Whatever the case, we haven't played around with that. That is still what we have to do. But we're going to see whether by including space, we can improve the reliability of these coefficients or the reliability of the model. So what we're then going to do is to say, okay, that's our model without including any spatial relationships. Let's go and have a look and see whether we should include space or not. Does space matter? So what we're going to do is we're going to go to our weights file. We're just going to click it, but we're going to keep our classic model. So that means it's going to generate the same model. It's not going to do a spatial, it's not going to include the spatial weights matrix, meaning we're not doing a spatial regression, but it's going to give us an idea of whether we should include spatial weights or not. Does space matter or not? So though it's not running, performing a spatial regression, it's still giving us an idea, giving us some clues whether space matters or not. So let's run that. So all I do is I click on that, and then, as I said, important, select your spatial weight matrices. Okay, there they all are. And we're going to see whether they materially make any difference or not. Okay, so we're going to run it, and it's done, and there it is. So you'll see that so it always populates from the top. So here's the previous one. You'll see there, it's generated at 1333, and this is generated at 1337. It always adds the latest output on top. Okay, so you'll see that it's still the same R square, it's still the same coefficients, it's still the same model diagnostics as what we've done without including or referencing the weights file, the spatial weights matrix. But now, interesting enough, it has a section here that specifically looks at spatial dependence. So what it does here, to a large degree, it runs the two models, and then in the background, it runs the normal model without the space, and in the background it runs the model with the space, with the spatial matrix, and then it compares the two, and then it says, okay, whether we should include the spatial dynamics or not. And this is basically what it says here. It says here that it's diagnostics for spatial dependence. And the spatial weights matrix that we're using is a clean one. So it's got its more on I statistic, which is very high, 0.726, which is highly statistically significant. So that implies that So your first clue that space does matter, we should bring in space, is that the spatial correlation is very high and statistically significant. But we've seen that before. We've seen it in our previous video tutorial. But what we're interested in is the next five ones. The Lagrange multiplier lag, the robust LM lag, the Lagrange multiplier error, the robust error, and then the sum. So the lag is, remember, if we go into the regression window, you'll see there's a spatial lag model and a spatial error model. So what it means is it is testing the relevance of the spatial lag and the spatial error. So where it says error or lag, it's testing the relevance of the spatial lag model. Where it says error, it's testing the significance of the spatial error model. And the SAMA, it is testing the combination of these two, the lag and the error model. Okay, so whether both is relevant, not just the lag or the error. Okay, so testing whether both is relevant. Now, the spatial lag means it's the ndvi that is dependent on its elevation, rain, and temperature of itself, its own temperature, rain, and elevation. But also, it's dependent on the elevation, rain, and temperature of its neighbors. That's a spatial lag one. Spatial error, it is based on the error term. So, once, remember, you have an error term here that's missing. So that error term is then divided between its own error term and the error term of its neighbors. So that's what this lag and the error means. The lag means it's testing the relevance of the spatial lag model. The error means it's testing this, the statistically the significance of the spatial error model. And the SAMA, it's testing the combination of the two. So in general, Lagrange indicates the relevance of both. Both the lag model and the error model. You see there? Zero and zero, low probability. The robust L suggests also the relevance of the lag, and the robust error also indicates the significance of the lag, and the SARMA indicates the significance of including both of them. So these statistics suggest that space indeed matters, and that we should include space both from a spatial lag point and a spatial error point. So that's our first clue, that space does indeed matter and we should include the space. Okay, so we haven't performed a spatial regression per se. All we've done is to get an understanding whether we should include space or not. And including space is highly recommended using these statistics. That's important, as I said, remember what the error and the lag and the error and the lag means. It's just referring to the spatial lag and the spatial error. And SAMA is the spatial lag and the spatial error combined. That's why there's two. Okay, so what we can do now is obviously run a spatial lag model. Okay, we run a spatial lag model. I'm not going to include all these things, although you can include it. Before we do that, let's quickly do the spatial, the queen, the order 2, and see what the results are there, whether there's any difference with it. Okay, so let's quickly run it. So, same formula, nothing different there. All I'm doing is changing my weight matrix from a queen order 1 to a queen order 2, meaning the neighbors and their neighbors is now included in this as neighbors to my location, not just my neighbors. So let's click run. Okay, so it's calculating because there's now much more neighbors. You'll see again, the statistics are all the same, nothing different. But now we'll see all the values are still the same, except the robust are suggesting that the lag order is not necessarily. You can see the modern eye statistics have decreased. All of these others still suggest either the lag or the error, except the robust LM lag test suggests that the lag, spatial lag, is not necessarily any good or irrelevant. However, in the sheer number of probabilities, that most of them are statistically significant or suggesting spatial inclusion, we can ignore this one. It's an outlier. It's a bit of an outlier. Let's quickly go nearest and see what the results look from that one. Let's run it. Now again, all of them are relevant. You can see all of them are relevant, more so than in the previous ones. Let's use the uniform one. That's now again a huge amount of neighbors, even more neighbors than the two, and also highly significant. So it doesn't matter which, does matter, but to a lesser degree in our instance, which spatial matrix we use, because they all are suggesting the relevance of space. Okay, so let's go back to our queen. Let's go to our spatial lag and let's say run it. Okay, so queen, and now we include the spatial lag. So it's going to take a bit of time because there's 4,903 locations. And it has to calculate the spatial matrix, spatial weight of each location for each of the independent variables. So that's quite a bit. Okay, so it has loaded. Let's have a look at our square. Our square... You can see the R-square is significantly improved. You'll see there are five variables, which is the weight matrix as well. R square is significantly improved. Elevation is still negative, rain is still positive. There's our weight matrix, the coefficient of our weight matrix. You see there is the coefficient of the weight matrix. There it sits. Okay. And you'll see the spatial weight matrix is highly statistically significant. It's highly statistically significant. And 0.87. So 0.87 of my neighbor's values are included in my value. So my NDVI is influenced by 0.87 of whatever the values of my neighbors are. So that's how the interpretation of that value lies. Okay, 0.87. We still have problems in our errors. It does improve. It does improve the output, but the improvement is not statistically significant, which is a bit of a bummer. But so including is statistically significant, but doesn't improve it that much. Let's have a look and see. So that's the spatial error model, and that's the thing that we have to look at. A spatial lag model, that's the variable that we need to focus on to see whether that variable is statistically significant or not. As already said, that we should include the lag, but as I said, including the lag doesn't necessarily improve the overall model per se. Okay, so let's quickly have a look and see what the results of the spatial error model looks like. Everything's still the same. Okay, let's quickly, before we go there, let's quickly run a Queen Order 2 model. Let's run that and see whether there's any difference there. Okay, now the neighbors have exponentially increased, so that's why it's taking a little bit longer to run, but we will get there. Just hang on. See whether there's any difference between including a order 1 queen or order 2 queen method. Let's have a look and see. It's almost there. It's almost there. Let's, okay, should be done. Okay, so let's have a look and see. R square is less. These values are still, so the weight matrix are still significant, 0.84. What was it? 0.87. So there's no significant difference there. Doesn't make much of a difference. So whether you use order 1 or order 2, it's not really making a hell of a difference. So the difference is very small, so it's not much of an issue. Let's use k-nearest 4. Let's run it. Requires systematic weights, not K. Okay, so you can't use K and N. Okay, so you can't use that. So you can only use the queen and the rooks. And not going to run either. Okay, so that one works. It's just the K and N. And okay, let's turn them. It's going to take a bit of time. It's not responding. Why? Okay. There's just too much of that now. Too many neighbors. Let's give it 5 seconds. Close. I hope close the program. Okay, so let me. Okay, sorry about that. I just had to quickly restart GeoDA. It crashed there. Part of the fun and games, I assume. Okay, so let's continue. So I've just rerun, if you go back, I just rerun the normal regression without the spatial matrix. Then I included the spatial matrix, but just for a test, not to actually run a spatial regression. And the test suggested including both the error and the lag. I went for that. Then I ran the lag model, the spatial lag model. The weight matrix are statistically significant and actually quite highly statistically significant, although the model itself still suffers and hasn't really improved that much, which is a bit of a concern. So let's quickly run the spatial error one. So let's do that. See, I'm not going to play around now with these weight matrices before it crashes again. So let's run a spatial error and see what the results look for that. Taking a bit of time, simply because it's 4,903 locations, so let's give it a bit of a proper chance. Okay, so let's have a look and see. Now here we've got a lambda. Okay, so the lambda here is the spatial. So in the spatial lag, we've got a coefficient called W and whatever, which was highly statistically significant. With the error, we have a lambda. The lambda is also statistically significant, highly statistically significant. As suggested in that other model, where it suggests that both the error and the lag should be included. You'll see there's the R. You see we still have issues around the model itself, although it's important to include it. It hasn't solved the problem. So including the spatial weight matrices are very important, but fundamentally this model still lacks a variable that we have to include. So the results are not improved. The non-improvement of the results are not because of the spatial weight matrix, but just simply because our model are misspecified. Not from a spatial point of view, but from a equation point of view. So we're lacking a variable or variables as our independent variables. That's what we're fundamentally lacking. But the model itself or the methodology itself says that space is important. We need to include space. And that makes sense if you think about it. Because it doesn't just rain at a particular location. It rains in a radius around that location. Elevation is not at a particular elevation. Is over period of the region of interest or over space, etc. Temperature is, you know, it's not just hot at this location, it's hot around the location. So including space makes sense, just logically it should be included. But as I said, the statistics suggest it should be included, both the error and the lag model. Just by the way, comparing the two, you can see the Chi information is 18983 for the error and 18772 for the lag. So always the one that has the smallest value is the better option. Is the better option. See, log log 94 and this is 93. So in this case, the error spatial error model has a smaller RKI and a Schwarz value than the spatial lag model. So it suggests that the spatial error model is actually a little bit better than the spatial lag model. But nonetheless, both are statistically. So it comes back to now with our studio is that where our studio now is a bit better, it can combine these two. Because we see that both of them are important. But we're treating them as individual models. We don't combine them. And this is where our studio is now nice. And that's, I think, where the Mansky model is so much better than the other two. Because it includes all of the spatial connections. Not just the spatial lag or the spatial error, but also the spatial... Yeah, so it includes spatial dependent, spatial independent, and spatial error. Includes all three of them. So that's why I think that's why I prefer to use RStudio and not GeoDA, because GeoDA only gives you these two options. However, GeoDA gives you the clues, gives you the hints, gives you the diagnostics to say we have to include it. And this is how you justify it, by these ones, because it suggests, and there it is, the Salma. It suggests that all of these are important. So, we can, let's say we can do the predicted values and there is and the actual values. We can save it to a table. So if we can run it, let's run it again. We can save the predicted values to our table or to a file. So if you want to download it and use it in Excel, for example, let's see, there it is, observations, there they are. It's actual, the predicted, the residual. And it's going to give you 4,900. You see, there's all of them. So we can do that. So there's a little bit of room that we can maneuver here, but not much per se. I'm not going to run different weight matrices because I'm just worried that the thing will crash and burn again. So, but again, it's a nice, neat little function. It does what it says it's going to do. It's going to do basic spatial regression, or just going to, it's going to help you to determine where the space is important, whether you should include it, and do two very basic spatial regression models and to run it and to see whether it improves or not, etc. So it's very useful to work with. And again, I think that the other nice thing is just to work with the weight matrices, just to evaluate them to see the sensitivity of the results of these models for the weight matrices. To see, you know, if I use this weight, that weight, what will be the outcome? Is there one that's better? Is there one that's worse? Whatever the case might be. So it's useful to play around. As I said, it's not like an RCD way to code and all these things. You just click, click, click button. So it's an easy, fast way of doing the basic spatial regression work. But as I said, I still prefer to do this in RStudio. However, as I said in my previous video, what I do enjoy working with GeoDA is the spatial weight and spatial correlation. That I prefer to work with in GeoDA. So let's pause it for there for now. We can work. Yeah, there's our regression. We've done a bit of time already, space. One thing that we still have to do is a bit of cluster work. And that we're going to do in our next video tutorial. It's going to focus on the cluster. And then I think we've exhausted the basic work in GeoDA. Now, you can actually bring in additional. Okay, let's pause it there. We can do that as a separate video tutorial. Let's pause it there, and end it there for this particular video tutorial on working with regression within spatial regression specifically within GeoDA. So with that said, thank you very much for joining me for this journey. Thanks for all your support and kind words. It genuinely helps me. It keeps the journey, it keeps the dream alive. Let's explore together. And please, if you haven't, please like, subscribe, share the video. Please smash those buttons. We need to get to our destination at some point. We need to get those numbers up. So, yeah, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. And stay tuned. I'll see you on the other side.